Baptist Church of Decatur. We're so happy that you logged on. Please grab your Bible and a cup of coffee and join us as we sing, pray, and worship together.
I'm reading Psalm 25, beginning at verse 3 and reading through 9. Do not let those who wait for you be put to shame. Let them be ashamed who are wantonly treacherous. Make me to know your ways, O Lord. Teach me in your paths. Lead me in your truth and teach me. For you are the God of my salvation. For you I wait all the day long. Be mindful of your mercy, O Lord, and of your steadfast love, for they have been from of old. Do not remember the sins of my youth or my transgressions. According to your steadfast love, remember me, for your goodness' sake, O Lord. Good and upright is the Lord. Therefore, he instructs sinners in the way. He leads the humble in what is right and teaches the humble his way. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Boys and girls, did you know that today is the first Sunday in the season of Lent? Lent is the time that we as the church take to get ready to come close to Easter Sunday. Over the next few weeks in our worship service, I will be sharing about Lent and some of the things that we as a church and you and your family can do to get ready to come close to Easter. And I will be sharing from this book called Make Room. So here is our story for today. This is the season of Lent. The church is dressed in purple. The world outside has its own seasons and its own colors. These days we are in the gray time between winter and spring. Some mornings, the puddles are frozen hard, and the bare branches of trees scrape a snow-white sky. Other days, the air is warmer, Ice is melting, and the air smells faintly of damp earth and rotting leaves. Under the ground, seeds and bulbs are sleeping, dreaming in shades of green. We are all waiting for spring. In church, we are waiting too, waiting for Easter. And while we wait, we get ready. Long ago, Jesus went out alone into the desert to get ready. Deep inside, he felt that God had important work for him to do, but he needed help to see clearly the way ahead. For 40 days and 40 nights, he was in the desert by himself, wondering, talking with God, listening, making choices. I wonder why Jesus went into the desert. Maybe it was quiet and still. Maybe Jesus thought he could hear God better there. Maybe he needed to make time to listen so he would know which way to go. During Lent, we make time to be with God. Every day we talk with God in different ways. Sometimes we pray with words. Sometimes we sing or listen to music. Sometimes we get out paints and crayons and create many colored prayers. Colors are like a different language we can all speak, even when we have no words. God understands. At other times, we make silence. We turn off the television and the music and stop talking for a while. And then we practice listening. Sometimes we read stories from the Bible and we wonder about what God might be telling us. Sometimes we just sit and rest in the quiet. During Lent, we pay attention to how we live. We think about the choices we make every day. We ask hard questions. Does what we say and do make the world a better place or not? Does how we live make God happy or not? Is there anything we need to change? Lent lasts for 40 days and 40 nights plus 6 Sundays. 40 days is a long time, but it takes time to get ready. So friends, as we begin this season of Lent, I hope that you and your family will take some time to decide how you are going to listen for God this season and how you will ask the hard questions. Maybe you can take time as a family to read the Bible every day or maybe once a week. Maybe you as a family set aside a time each day where everyone just sits and is quiet to listen to God. Whatever you decide, I hope that your family will take some time this Lent so that you can get ready to come close to the mystery of Easter. Let's pray together. Dear God, thank you for loving us. Help us to get ready to come close to the mystery of Easter. During this season of Lent, help us to listen for your voice. We pray this in your name. Amen.
Friends, let us pray. Lord God, we come to you now asking you to be with us. We long for your Spirit to descend upon us. We long to hear your voice. We long to be drawn up out of our chaotic lives, dripping with the water of life. For you alone are able to descend, to speak, and to raise us up. You alone are able to awaken us, to renew our minds, to save us. But we often do not wish to follow the prompting of your Spirit, which drives us out into the wilderness as often as it comforts us. We often want cheap grace. We want forgiveness without our having to make amends. We want to be saved without having to be honest or accountable. Forgive us for this selfish desire and drive us into places of truth and clarity, even when those places are not comfortable or easy. Drive us into places where we can see ourselves and others, no matter how different or unsavory or contrary to good taste, that we might see them as you see them, as beloved children of God who, like us, carry your image. For you and for your always present spirit, we give thanks. For your readiness to speak to us, we give thanks. For our deep set and persistent desire to please you, we give thanks. For your undying desire to commune with us, we give thanks. And for sojourns in the wilderness, we give thanks. We ask that you make us ready, Lord God, to be your servants. We don't know what this call will mean as it is lived out in this beautiful and brutal world, but we do ask to be made ready for it nonetheless. We ask to be faithful. We ask that we become simple, that we become single-minded, and that we become whole, so that one day we may hear you call us beloved. Amen.
Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I'm very thankful this morning to introduce you to Reverend Byron Bell. Byron is our preacher for this morning and will be sharing with us from the Gospel of Mark, the first chapter, verses 9 through 15. Byron is a newly ordained minister of the gospel. We here at First Baptist Decatur had the great privilege of ordaining Byron this past fall. Byron currently serves as chaplain at Emory Midtown Hospital. And as you can imagine, during this difficult time of pandemic, Byron's role has been essential for families to feel the comfort and the support that a chaplain like Byron supplies. He also is ministering to the staff, the doctors, the nurses, the healthcare workers that right now are filled with exhaustion and stress and tension as they continue to work and minister in this difficult time. So we're so thankful, Byron, for all that you do on our behalf as your congregation. We're thankful for the many ways that God is using you to heal brokenheartedness and touch the lives of people in crisis. And we're thankful today for the words that you're going to share from the Gospel of Mark. We're also thankful that you are a new father and Courtney, your wife, is a new mother to Naomi, your beautiful new daughter who was just born recently. So lots of exciting things happening in your life and in our lives, even in the midst of the broader difficulties of our world. We're so thankful for you, for the words that you're going to share, and for the life and the witness that you are living. Let us hear together now from this first chapter of the Gospel of Mark, verses 9 through 15. In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan River. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit of God descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." And the Spirit immediately drove him out into the wilderness. And he was in the wilderness for 40 days, tempted by Satan, and was with the wild beast, and the angels waited on him. Now, after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God, and saying, "The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news. Brothers and sisters, this is the word of God. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Morning, church family. For those who don't know, my name is Byron. I'm one of the most recent ordained ministers for the church, and I'm glad to be here with you on this first Sunday of Lent. Thank you first to Pastor David and to the deacons, the leaders of First Baptist Church of Decatur, for allowing me the opportunity just to share during this first Sunday of Lent. For those who don't know, I am married. I have a beautiful bride named Courtney. And we recently had our first child named Naomi, who in many ways keeps us on our toes, both figuratively and very literally, as we try to put her down to rest and to sleep. So in some ways, I enter into this text as a fellow transitioner in many different ways, also because of Naomi and entering the fatherhood. But I think this text also offers us transitions and what we can do and how Jesus embodied transition by listening to the Spirit. Because the Spirit is speaking. And this text invites us to hear, to receive, and to respond with the speaking of the Spirit within us and through us. And so from the beginning of the gospel, the writer creates a connection to display who Jesus is and how he's bringing a good news. For the first century hearers, this pronouncement of Jesus bringing a good news would have immediately clicked to them as they heard Son of God, the political undertones posed by the author. Good news in the Greco-Roman world is linked to the announcement of a military victory. And here we find Mark saying that new victory is beginning. Unlike the militant conquest familiar to the hearers, which would have included bombastic announcements through instruments, singing, dancing, you name it, we are told in this passage of a voice crying out in the wilderness. Drawing from the passage in Isaiah, the gospel writer is proclaiming that a prophet is once again calling the Judean community to repent and prepare themselves for who is to come after him. Up until this point, some scholars have noted how there had been a time when there were no prophets to speak, for hundreds of years perhaps. It is in this historical backdrop that we encounter the personification of the Spirit's voice embodied by John the Baptist. ushering into a new opportunity for the people of God to prepare themselves for encounter with God. In 2008, I had the privilege of traveling to Israel to promote an interfaith dialogue using football as a medium. During this trip, I had the incredible opportunity to see scripture really come to life, like seeing tangible things, the Valley of Elah, so many different things. But I also had the privilege of going to actually the River Jordan, which is where our text cites us for today. The site we went to obviously was very manicured, and it had groundskeeping, green space, all the amenities you think for a tourist trap, essentially. And so what we did, after reading the passage like we hear from today, myself and the others from the group took turns baptizing each other. It was a surreal experience to be literally submerged in the same body where Jesus was millennia ago as they walked from Jerusalem to Jordan. Unfortunately, as my friend was performing the ritual on me, we both ended up slipping, leaving both of us flailing, trying to find our footing in the middle of the river. To my friend's offense, I was much bigger than from playing college football. And while I didn't hear a voice from heaven upon arising out of the water, I did thank heaven that I actually survived the encounter, because it could have turned out pretty bad. Thankfully, as our text demonstrates, belovedness comes by being, and not our productivity or our mistakes. In verse 10, the gospel writer describes the awesome scene of the sky being torn open, literally being ripped apart in the Greek, and the Spirit descending upon Jesus like a dove, upon which a voice from heaven calls Jesus beloved, or one who is divinely loved. Beloved in this passage is derived from the root word agape, which we're fairly familiar with that. It is a divine love that the Spirit affirms that Jesus, before he has done anything, before he has said anything, at least in this gospel, is one in whom God is well pleased. This, according to my commentary, is believed to be a private theophany, or a private manifestation or encounter with God, which is helpful, at least for me, that it stands as a reminder that our identity as children of God, we are who God says we are. Woven to the fabric of our society, and sometimes even our own spirit, there can be a constant pressure to produce, or rather, a pressure to be perfect. While being productive is good, and striving to have high morales and goals is good, and serves its own purpose in the right context, understanding that like Jesus, our belovedness comes from being in Christ. And it's from this beloved affirmation that we have the literary privilege of seeing how it was the Spirit who drove or cast Jesus into the wilderness. I must admit, although I have read this passage many times, it seemed odd, for why would the Spirit send Jesus to the desert so abruptly? In both the Gospel of Matthew and Luke, Jesus is said to be led, seems very nicely, be led by the Spirit or empowered by the Spirit. But in Mark, we are told that Jesus is cast out by the Spirit into the wilderness. This sudden shift is jarring, at least for me. But if we remember how the gospel writer introduces Jesus, we can get greater clarity as to why Jesus was driven into the wilderness. And that is in that Jesus is coming to bring a good news as the Son of God. Jesus, portrayed by Mark, is on a mission to bring a new world order, or perhaps better stated, a renewed world order in which creation is once again in alignment with God's kingdom. This is why willfully listening to the Spirit allows himself to be tempted by Satan, surrounded by wild beasts, and tended by angels. It is both reminiscent of, again, the Isaiah passage before mentioned, as well as images of Eden, where scholar Dr. Alan Colbert suggests that Christ is now the new Adam, in which he has been driven by the Spirit. Jesus confronts Satan and other evil powers, which are believed to dwell in very desolate places. And so by going to the wilderness, Jesus is also entering into a critical space of discernment within the Hebrew tradition and human experience. Within the Hebrew tradition, Jesus' wilderness experience explains or echoes that of the Exodus, in which the people of God, the people of Israel, wandered within the wilderness for 40 years. After being liberated by Pharaoh, the Israelites, albeit because of their own actions according to the books of Exodus, have to endure their hardships of the wilderness. During both the Exodus and Jesus' experience, however, we again have the literary privilege to see that God is with them. There is a theme of not only discernment in the desert, but deliverance. While both instances depict individuals who are driven to the wilderness, God does not leave them there unattended. Whether it was from manna from heaven or a guiding fire by night or angels who waited on Jesus, God guided people to deliverance and provided them what they needed to endure the wilderness experience. It is from drawing on this experience, I am reminded of the brilliant womanist scholar Dolores Williams and her work, Sisters in the Wilderness. Using the story of Hagar and God's deliverance for her, Williams describes how the wilderness experience is also a symbolic term that can be used to represent a near destruction situation, particularly for Black women, in which God gives personal direction to the believer and thereby helps her make a way out of what she thought was no way. Williams admits that the wilderness motif has been linked to the African-American experience for centuries and is evident by spirituals, including Deep River, which was incredibly sung earlier before I came on. But hear again the lyrics of the song. As the gospel feasts, that promised land where all is peace. Feel by the vocalist is a desire for liberation and peace from the oppression of Jim Crow and racism. A peace that comes from a willingness to venture into the wilderness, not only in a societal sense, but within ourselves. The prolific American writer and activist James Baldwin, I believe, is correct in assessing how the history of America's issues with race is not something we read, but also is present within us in all that we do. There is a wilderness within each of us that God is wanting us to cast into so that God can deliver us through it and is using it to transition us to see the kingdom more clearly. But let's be honest, let's be real. We all, to some degree, are aware of what this wilderness is within us and may not want to walk through it. To some degree, we may not have to walk through it because of how we're placed in a social location, whether economically, status, where it may be, or privilege. But if we are going to do this internal excavation, it will take some humility. Thankfully, as our song for today states, God leads the humble in what is right and teaches the humble the way of God. It is difficult work, but it is work I believe the Spirit calls to us and that Jesus embodies, even in difficult times, or rather, especially in difficult times. Moving to our last transition in the text, the first sentence is important in displaying how Jesus is continuing to bring a new world order. It says, after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God, saying, the time is fulfilled, the kingdom of God has come near, repent, believe in the good news. What caught my attention is the immediacy and the timing of Jesus proclaiming the good news. John getting arrested for what Jesus is doing now doesn't seem to be the best time for Jesus to begin his ministry. But I love that he did. In fact, Jesus used the word kairos, meaning that this is now the opportune time to proclaim the good news. Up to this point, the Spirit spoke to Jesus. But at this point, we have Jesus empowered by the Spirit, courageously proclaiming the kingdom of God is now near. It obviously wasn't a convenient time for Jesus to speak, but after going through his own wilderness experience, Jesus had the kingdom courage to speak and to speak with conviction. The Spirit is speaking. Will we have the kingdom courage to respond to his calling in our own experience? As I mentioned earlier, I'm a hospital chaplain, which has given me a pretty interesting perspective, given the various intersections going on in society right now with the pandemic. This was none more true than on January 6th, as the White House was stormed by rioters, some of which were wearing or carrying Christian symbols, while also brandishing nooses, immediately reminding me of the ever-present evil forces which would want to do harm to me simply because of the color of my skin. While working to create space for medical staff during work, but process and also processing my own reaction, I couldn't help but ask myself internally, what will the church proclaim after witnessing these events? It's with great privilege that I can say that we as a church had the kingdom courage to say that such actions are wrong and do not testify to the God we see in our Bible. As a Black man with a Black daughter, I appreciate such kingdom courage of our church. And I think it invites us as individuals to go into our own wilderness experience, whatever that may look like, wherever that may lead us. Because in many ways, now is Kairos time, the opportune time to allow the Spirit to speak to and through us. May the Spirit speak through us to affirm the immeasurable worth of each person, not in spite of who they are, but because of who they are as God's image bearers. May the Spirit speak through us so that we may acknowledge our own mistakes of how we have unknowingly brought harm to others. May the Spirit guide us to deliver us from temptation of comfort and from evil of injustice. For in that lies the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. The question then comes, how then might we begin this internal trek to our own wilderness, for which I have found two questions helpful for me in processing this. Maybe we take time and ask the Spirit to first show to us during the season of Lent, what is the wilderness within me that you're driving me to? It may be very specific, in which God is calling you to. And secondly, how can I meet you in the wilderness spirit? In asking these questions, you may be encouraged knowing that God is already there waiting on us to deliver us from it. The Spirit is speaking to each of us during this season. May we receive the word of the Lord and may God continue to proclaim the good news through us. For the kingdom of God has come near. May grace be with you. Thank you all. Amen.
There's a sweet, sweet spirit in this place, and I know that it's the Spirit of the Lord. There are sweet expressions on each face.
As we conclude this hour of worship, go out into the world knowing that God still speaks, be it in bushes of flame or in whispers, and still tells us that we are on holy ground because we are in the presence of our very God. And so may all your comings and goings on that holy ground this week be done in service of God's steadfast love and mercy. Amen.
2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
May your peace be an anchor in the stormy tide. May your hope run like a river that'll never run dry. May your burdens grow light. May your worries subside. This is my prayer for you. May your soul grow deep. May your joy run wild. May your heart know the face of mercy as smile. May your faith come to let you believe like a child. This is my prayer for you. This is my prayer.